During the early dynastic Egyptian uprising of civilization, the life of the people in that area centered on the Nile River. Early archaeological discoveries shows that there were in existence a great knowledge of working and cultivating a broad range of crops around 4000 BC. The knowledge that once was the foundation of a great civilization, it seemed, tripped through to the survivors, their stories, their beliefs. These were the foundations for early life in the re-emergence of civilization and what we now refer to as ancient history. Plentiful resources were available for the development of the early urban societies in the Nile River Valley. Mineral-rich clay offered excellent development processes of the soil with less fertilization required and irrigation. Also in the surrounding desert regions, there are caches of limestone, granite, and precious metals. At this time, there had been tensions in the society with closely encroaching urban groups. Yet in spite of the power vacuum in Egypt, there was a slow move towards unification under the king Narmer. This unification was important as it set the stage for the monarchical dynastic system of governance that Egyptian dynastic pharaohs would use. Egypt's early dynasties are widely considered to be one of the world's first stable monarchy empires, in contrast to the battling city-states of Mesopotamia for this same period of civilized re-emergence after cataclysmic events besieged humankind to the brink. Yet, we survived, and the survivors must have remembered certain aspects of a before time in history when these biblical events unfolded. Therefore, the movement of a people as a whole is the incorporation of a need and want for stability in the masses. Stability in the lineage of the dynasties was achieved through the means of leveraging the religious cults of Egypt. The kings of Egypt were claimed to have been the descendants of Ra, the sun god, as the queens would be impregnated by Ra during the pregnancy of the first male heir. The divinity ascribed to the succeeded heirs helped to impress considerable control over the people. Along with Ra being considered an important deity to the ruling class, a tradition of revering Horus was also passed on. At first, he was merely a protector of the royals, but with the arrival of the dynasties in the 3rd century BC, he was integrated as a family member of Ra, who was especially meant to protect the kings against the god Seth. Though there was a great amount of stability in the early dynasties, buttressed by divine claims, more pragmatic reasons brought down the old kingdom. Ineffective leadership, which could not be improved no matter how many claims of divinity are made, were to blame for the fragmentation of Egypt's kingdom after the death of Pharaoh in 2175 BC. With the breakdown of central authority, smaller states governed Egypt for a period before another powerful group took over, the Middle Kingdom. The emergence of the Middle Kingdom under the leadership of Mentenhotep II of the 11th dynasty led to a time that is considered one of the most prosperous in Egyptian history, with advances in administration and fine art crafts like jewelry were some of the notable achievements of this new dynastic age. During the second intermediate period, outside rulers, the Hyksos, reigned over a number of principalities. This was different than the early intermediate periods when internal splinter groups ruled Egypt. Some of the most notable leaders in ancient Egypt history emerged out of the new kingdom, which arrived in 1550 after reign of the Hyksos. Hatshepsut was a greatly influential leader and unique in that she was one of the few female leaders in Egypt during her reign as co-regent in the event of her husband's death in 1479 BC to rule alongside her stepson Thotmose III. She had styled herself with a king-like title of the She Horus of Fine Gold and had many temple reliefs made of herself. One of her notable achievements that was afforded by the prosperity brought about during her reign allowed her to begin the building of the temples in the Valley of the Kings, where many later kings would be buried. These are the tombs of the pharaohs, not the pyramids of Giza.
The size of these galleries and these tunnels and passageways in the limestone bedrock. And you can see the surfaces are covered with hieroglyphs, and the surfaces are incredibly flat. Another thing is there are depressions in the walls and rooms off to the sides, and they're almost always, if not always, bilaterally symmetrical. So here you see a niche on one side and a niche on the other side in exactly the same position. Unfortunately, I know nothing about hieroglyphs themselves, and my fascination is not so much with the dynastic people, though I very much respect their brilliant history. It's these strange, out-of-place objects and just the galleries themselves. Now here is a massive granite box with crude hieroglyphics carved on the surfaces in comparison to the box itself. And how was that box created? The granite for the box almost undoubtedly came from Aswan, which is to the south. And I would estimate that that box by itself weighs approximately 60 tons. Also, there is catastrophic damage to each of the boxes that we looked at. Is this the result simply of tomb robbers or something more catastrophic that happened in pre-dynastic times, the evidence of which we see in places like Karnak and Tanis and the Ramesseum and other locations? So once again, it's the sheer sense of scale of these massive tunnel systems that go into the bedrock in the Valley of the Kings, and of course all of the Valley of the Queens as well. And we've recently learned that the Valley of the Kings and Valley of the Queens are connected by a series of tunnels.
Another impressive leader in the New Kingdom was Amenhotep III, who introduced many religious innovations into the New Kingdom with the implementation of a radical variant of the new solar theology, in which a focus on worship of the sun and a rejection of previous religious ideas and beliefs which were previously practiced in Egypt, and this led to one of the greatest achievements of Amenhotep's reign. The worship of the sun was already being practiced in Egyptian culture, but this adjustment then moved to the god which infused all belief, Amun-Ra, a combination of the traditional sun god Ra with the god Amun, and at this point, the belief in the one almighty god had taken root. The son of Amenhotep III, Amenhotep IV, or better known as Akhenaten, one of the most controversial kings of all time, and he continued these religious reforms and centered the sun worship now on the physical sun, Aten. Akhenaten installed himself as the primary intermediary with Aten and sought to attack all other deities, which led to the closing of many temples throughout all of Egypt, but this backfired because with these temple closures, faith dwindled and much land flowed from the king and cultural landmarks like feast days were lost. The slow degeneration of the new kingdom came during the 11th century BC, making a decline that Egypt would not fully recover from.
Well, you know, it is a long story to condense, but it has been the subject of my life. I had an interest in Egypt when I was 8 years old, having a connection to the Sphinx and Great Pyramid, but it wasn't then that I decided that the study of Egypt or Egyptology would be my life. But the real turning point for me was in 1968. I had gone into the U.S. Air Force for 4 years during the Vietnam conflict and decided I wanted to read things that I did not have time for in college. And I'd always been a fan of Sigmund Freud. The last thing Sigmund Freud wrote was a series of articles for the psychoanalytic journal Imago in Vienna, Austria. 1934, he wrote an article postulating, was Moses an Egyptian priest? Was Moses an Egyptian? The reason why, the leaders in Egyptology in that time were the Germans. So in 1846, Richard Lipsius, German Egyptologist, had discovered what we today call Amarna, a city that this particular king established away from other cities. It led to the discovery of this particular individual who had been lost to history up until that point, even to Egyptology, because his records had been erased. He took a title, Akhenaten. It's a long understanding to really develop what the title means. Ach means the shadow or the shade. Aten is a phase, the fourth phase of the stage of the sun. Aten, the wiser, shade or shadow of the wiser. Basically, this particular king decided to be a revolutionary, to change what was the pattern of what we call dynastic Egypt at the time. We're talking about 1350 BCE. He decided to break with the established religion at that time, which was called the religion of Amun, which is the last phase of the sun. You know, we could go into a great deal about the phase of the sun back some other time. But he wanted to return to the previous cycle, Aten, the full flowering of consciousness, where there were no priests, there were no religion, it was only pure spirituality. So he broke with that tradition and changed his title from Amenhotep, which he was born with, Amun is pleased, Amun is completed, the fulfillment of Amun, to Akhenaten. He left the city of Thebes, which is now Luxor, and built a whole city, which is called Akhenaten. We call it today Amarna, and lived there with several, you know, his followers. It's a long story. But then, to the point where I broke the book from light into darkness, Freud had written other articles. If Moses was an Egyptian, he was a priest of this particular king, because it seemed like this particular king wore what we call in Judaism Mosaic Judaism, the teachings that were given to Moses supposedly from Egypt. Freud believed it came directly from this king. I believe Freud was right. This, to my opinion, is the greatest thing Freud gave to humanity, not his theory of psychoanalysis, not his theories of dreams, but of the story of this particular king.
Militarization of the state led to loss of resources, and loss of trade routes meant a blow to prosperity in Egypt. While many kings tried to channel the successes of the last successful king in the new kingdom, Ramses, none of them were able to meet his same level of his success. As the kings wanted to show their prominence, there was an emphasis on building increasingly impressive tombs to use during their time in the afterlife. King Tutankhamun's tomb, one of the few to be left fully intact upon discovery, was an example of the goods put aside for a pharaoh in this afterlife journey, with his tomb having a storeroom for oils and foodstuffs, an inherited ideology from a cosmic journey that would have been undertaken by the gods and repeated by human beings, like a capsule, a spacecraft, some might say, or better yet, an escape pod. The need for physical possessions for such a journey would strike a chord with the thought on what the root of the idea may be. But anyway, these notable tombs, like the Valley of the Kings, continue as memorials to the culture around death in dynastic Egypt regarding past events at this time. Along with the magnitude of the tombs themselves, the scale of mummified remains, the elaborate religious symbolism that was behind many of the items found in the tombs, and an example is multiple types of wine included in Tutankhamun's tomb, which, according to the experts on the matter, represented both the life cycle of sunrise and sunset, which pointed towards both Ra and Osiris. With this journey of the sun through the sky, it would symbolize in Egyptian history as the king's journey into the afterlife. As with every other tomb of a notable, there were also provisions for the afterlife. And though not all individuals were able to prepare so lavishly for their burials, it did emphasize the importance of death rituals in dynastic Egypt. The preparation, it seemed, on Earth for a greater journey to the stars. The survivors, as we now are a population, still felt this abandonment. The preparation is what they remembered for the departure that never came, in the trauma of the mind of the cataclysmic soul of the human being. We try to forget for the purposes of the future of our people, but we forgot more than we know, and now we are straining to remember. The use of writing was also an important cultural development throughout much of Egypt at this time. Scribes, especially in the Middle Kingdom, held a high status above other trades and were utilized to help make administration of the kingdom more efficient. The use of both hieroglyphics and hierotext script, a simplified version of hieroglyphics, was common. Written texts were most commonly found to be day-to-day, while hieroglyphics normally showed more elaborate carvings. The frequency with which writing and literacy appeared in this age in Egypt allowed for a miniature classical age in which a love of learning for its own sake was available. With the growth in volumes of literary text, eventually the pharaohs of particular periods would have their appearances carved onto temple walls, telling tales of the conquest, or into great stela like the dream stelas, where Thutmose dreams of his encounter with the Sphinx, who orders him to rebuild the great monument, and he does so in the likeness of Pharaoh. Again, providing an insight into the links and magnitude of the spread of a dominant culture and the understanding that the king is gods represented here on earth, something today's monarchs still hold in the highest regard imaginable. It is important to understand this culture and role in history that both they seem to have played and what we have been told they may have played. Sure, the dynastic period of Egypt is an outstanding minefield of past events that we are only now really beginning to re-understand after centuries of volleyed efforts of explanation. These people of trust must have known of certain lies because the truth in many cases does not have any manifestation of the underlying lie that upon society it was foretold and upheld as a truth. The learning of this period has confused an even older civilization with this very dynastic civilization, who fled to the Nile region during times of survival, began to uncover the wealth of the past, emerge into a state of dynasty through the recovery of past events, which they tried to incorporate into this belief system that spread into every aspect of Egyptian life during the dynastic period. And we thought this may interest the subscribers of the Lost History Channel, so we thought we would bring it to your attention. But what do you guys think about this anyway? Comments below, and as always, thank you for watching.
And the fact that you could film and take photographs inside the Valley of the Kings in these massive chamber systems, which is excellent, because what's the point in even visiting these if you're not allowed to take photos and video? And how far does this tunnel system go is my question. We weren't given access to the entire system, but some of these are much more extensive than even what I have been able to film here, this what you're looking at. There you see some soot on the ceiling, probably from dynastic or later times, from people living inside, or maybe tomb robbers being in there. Beautiful bright colors. These most of these colors are the original from dynastic times. They haven't been retouched, but they're still brilliant. And here we are slowly walking out of one of these massive tombs. Incredibly impressive. And this is quite possibly one of the most amazing of the ancient tomb systems, which is accessible with the standard fee that you pay when you go into the Valley of the Kings. This is Merin Ptah's tomb, and it is hundreds of feet long, carved into the bedrock of limestone. And again, look on the left and right side, you see those depressions, which are bilaterally symmetrical. whether they were actually functional for what, I don't know. But it's the sense of scale which completely blows me away about exploring. We just keep descending and descending and descending into Merin Ptah's tomb. And further down. And then we have rooms off to the left and right-hand side. It's a very complex tomb structure. And down we go. Hundreds of feet. Again, how these possibly could have been made by dynastic people with adzes and chisels and picks and shovels, I don't believe it. I think this is a much older inheritance. And there you see a massive granite box lid. And going past there, we go even further down to where there are the remains of a giant box, again, having catastrophic damage to it. Most people would think the damage was done by tomb robbers, but we also see strange discoloration. You see the darker tones on the surface of the stone there. And this box is very strange. So-called sarcophagus. Because as we go around to the side, you can see that there's a doorway into it. Whether that was original or created later, I don't know. And on the interior surface, again, these strange burn-like discolorations. And then this magnificent sarcophagus made of granite. It's slightly rough in terms of texture. It could be that it was never completed, but it doesn't have the high polish of many of the other giant granite statues which are located in Egypt. Just a beautiful, beautiful functional sculpture. And once again, the strange discoloration that you see, it's much more extensive on some of the other boxes located in other tombs.